you're in Maui during the height of humpback whale season and you just go for a swim in the ocean, typically you will hear the chorusing in the background of humpback whale song. Humpback whale males are the ones who sing.
The humpback whale song is kind of otherworldly because it combines these elements of low frequency sounds together with these really high notes and all kinds of things sort of in between. And that's part of the reason what makes the song so interesting and unique, because you really get the sense that the whales are trying to kind of show off their range.
It's quite beautiful and melodic, and other than human language, it's been touted as one of the most complex vocalizations in the animal kingdom.
Surfacing.
Each year, approximately half of the North Pacific humpback whale population migrates roughly 3,000 miles from its feeding grounds in southeastern Alaska to its breeding grounds in Hawaii.
The majority of the whales will be here between January and March.
When they're in the breeding grounds, other than newborn calves that are feeding on their mother's milk, the whales are largely fasting.
So the amount of time that they can spend here is going to be dictated by the energy stores that they've built up over the summer.
While in the breeding grounds, the male whales perform their haunting song.
All the whales in Hawaii sing approximately the same song.
Based on genetics, now there is believed to be 14 distinct population segments of humpback whales around the world.
There are very large differences between the song that is produced, let's say, here in the North Pacific and what we have in the South Pacific, because those are entirely different populations. And those whales do not interact with each other.
There's three or four other whales singing.
When the breeding season starts, the whales are singing the same song that they ended with at the previous season. The song evolves in certain ways over the course of a breeding season. There may be innovators in the singing community in Hawaii. It may be that there are whales from other breeding areas that go up to similar feeding grounds and they've come down to the Hawaii breeding grounds and are bringing some changes in the song that the other males are adopting. And that combination leads to the song kind of evolving over the course of a season. So at the end of the season, when you record song, there are some slight differences that are very noticeable from the beginning of the season. If you record song over several years, you may hear that those small changes lead to large-scale changes.
There's still so much we don't understand, even just some very basic questions as to what the function of their song is, and there's just been a lot of debate about that.
How do scientists study humpback whale song? And what might it tell them about the fitness of an individual whale?
Major funding for this program was provided by the Bachelor Foundation, encouraging people to preserve and protect America's underwater resources, and by the William J. and Tina Rosenberg Foundation, the Do Unto Others Trust, and by the following.
Whales have long held a place in Hawaiian culture.
We all pay tribute to the whale. And one of the chants was Amakua, which is a guardian angel. So it talks about the whale being a guardian angel of a family.
Eyo ko mako,
e nā kohola. E malama o kō e nā kohola. E ulu I ka lani, e ulu ka nua, e ulu ka paaina o Hawaii nei. E ho mai ka iki, e ho mai I kaika, e ho mai aka mai, e ho mai mā pōpō pono, e ho mai papalua, e ho mai ka mana. It says that the whale exists everywhere in heaven. It has a lot of knowledge and a lot of experience, and it's very strong, and it takes care of us.
While historically, toothed whales have always played an important role in Hawaiian culture, today, humpback whales are clearly the most recognized whale species in Hawaii. Tourists come from far and wide to observe these majestic creatures.
They generate tens of millions of dollars in tourist interest.
The island's clear waters are also a great place for researchers to study the baleen whales.
We have several projects that we're currently engaged in, and one of them is trying to get a better handle on how song may function.
Scientists Adam Pack and Mark Lammers have been researching humpback whales for decades, often collaborating on different studies. To research whale song, the team works on the leeward side of Maui, inside the Hawaiian Islands Humpback Whale National Marine Sanctuary. In the United States, humpback whales are given special protections under the Marine Mammal Protection Act.
Federal regulations mandate that people have to stay 100 yards away from whales.
We have specialized federal permits that allow us to do our research, which includes approaching closer than 100 yards.
Look up dive, 100%.
Okay, we have an animal up at 12 o'clock.
Is he still singing?
Okay. Yeah, that's barely. Animal 12 o'clock, how far away?
150 yards.
Okay.
Okay.
In order to be able to collect our data, we have to locate where the singer is. And the physics of underwater sound make it challenging because underwater sound travels 4.5 times faster than in air, which makes the wavelengths longer. So if we just stick our head in the water, we're not going to be able to tell you, you know, where the sound is coming from. So what we do is we use a directional hydrophone system, which has effectively two receivers that are spaced at 4.5 times the spacing between our ears. And that allows us to kind of use those kind of amplitude differences that we would normally use in air to effectively resolve which direction the song is coming from.
Okay, right again.
And that allows us to then move closer to him.
We're interested in the characteristics of a humpback whale song itself. The song is complex, it's hierarchically organized.
So what you see here is the full cycle of the song. And each one of these little bright dots right here is representative of basically a song unit. So for example, here we have a certain type of unit that's repeated, and one phrase begins and ends about right here. Another one begins and ends approximately here. And then another one about over here, and then another one over here, and then the final one is right there. So you can see really the structure of how the units contribute to different types of phrases and how different phrases are organized into the themes that make up the entire song.
After each song cycle, which on average lasts between 10 to 18 minutes, the whale surfaces to breathe before resubmerging to start the song all over again. Once the animal dives back down, the team joins him in the water to collect their data.
Animals tend to sing kind of canted about anywhere from about 45 to 60 degrees down.
Most often they're alone. Sometimes they're singing while in association with other whales.
The humpback whale song is just in itself very beautiful, but when you get in the water with them and you're right next to a singer and you feel that the tips of your fins and your lungs vibrating as a result, it definitely leaves a very strong impression on you.
It's humbling, really.
To document the behavior of the whale, Adam records video while in the water. He also uses the video to measure the size of the animal, using a technique called videogrammetry, which he developed with his colleagues.
For that technique, you need to know the distance from the camera to the whale. And so I am continuously videotaping that whale, and I wait for the singer to straighten out. Then I have a high-frequency handheld sonar device, higher than the whales can hear. Basically, it's like a fish finder.
When activated, this sonar device makes a clicking sound while measuring the distance between the camera and the whale. This measurement displays on a small LCD screen, which Adam records with his video camera.
So when I'm back at our laboratory at UH Hilo and I'm watching video of this, I'll hear a click sound and I know that's the moment I have to capture that frame on my computer, and then I'll basically measure the distance on the computer screen from the tip of the rostrum to the tip of the tail, and then there's an easy algorithm that we use to calculate the length of the whale.
While Adam captures video, Mark records the whale's song, so its acoustic characteristics can be analyzed later.
I will position myself towards the head of the animal and start making my recordings. And I also have a handheld dive sonar that I use to measure the distance that I'm at from the singing whale. And those measurements are then used for us to then be able to calculate the source level, so the amplitude that the whale is singing. We'll capture as much of the song as we can, and ideally, if we can, we'll capture, you know, multiple sequences of the song.
What we're interested in is whether that song of a particular singer carries information about that singer's fitness.
If we consider that all the whales are effectively trying to produce the same song, some are going to be inherently better at it, presumably, than others. And that's exactly what we're trying to quantify. It's just that range and that variability that exists among the whales. Are some whales truly better at producing song at both low and high frequencies? Are other whales maybe a little bit more limited in terms of the range that they can produce?
Are things like the loudness of the song, right, the amplitude of that song, is that related to larger body size? Would that represent a singer with high levels of testosterone?
We're interested in the testosterone levels because we know that when whales enter a reproductive state, those levels go up quite dramatically. Is the quality of the song related to their testosterone levels, which could then help them broadcast to their competitors and their potential mates their willingness and their ability to compete vigorously?
To measure the testosterone levels, the experts need to collect a small blubber sample after they've completed their in-water data collection.
Adam will shoot a biopsy dart, which collects a very small sample of blubber and skin using a hollow-tipped arrow that just bounces right off the whale. And then we go and collect that.
At the end of each day, Adam works up the biopsy samples in a sterile work environment.
So here we have a small amount of blubber. There's the skin. And so we're going to send it up to our colleague up at University of Alaska Fairbanks. And they have a laboratory up there where they can do our steroid hormone analysis for us.
While Mark and Adam still need to collect more data to draw definitive conclusions about the correlations between a singer's hormone levels and its size and acoustic characteristics, they're already able to tease out some preliminary findings.
Larger whales may be able to produce somewhat louder songs. And we know that the larger a whale is, the more likely to win in a competition for a mate.
A number of hypotheses have been proposed over the years to understand the purpose of the humpback song.
From helping sort of stimulating females to commit to estrus, to providing some sort of a homing beacon for migrating whales, none of them are necessarily mutually exclusive. From what we can tell, it is a display. When we see singers being joined by other whales, it almost always is by other males. We don't see females actively approaching singers. And so if other males are the ones that are really coming in and paying close attention to the song of the singer, it suggests that there's something in the quality of the song that they're homing in on and trying to sort of perceive.
It could benefit other males who may encounter the singer again. So they have some information so as not to engage this male in physical competition and perhaps get injured.
While Adam and Mark are busy collecting their data, other members of the research team make observations and take photographs of the animal's tail flukes and other distinguishing body parts. These images will be used later for photo identification.
And the fluke ID that we gather is important because our historical archive of humpback whale individual identification photographs dates back to 1976. It's one of the largest archives in the world of humpback whales. It contains some 23,000 images, or what we call observations, of over 7,000 individual whales. So it's a rich database.
Unique markings on the whale's tail flukes make it possible to distinguish between individuals.
One of the whales that we came across yesterday was a singer, and I was curious whether we had seen this whale before. So you can see that this is a whale that we call a 75% white, meaning 3/4 of the ventral surface of the tail fluke is white. And there are some markings like this scar. And so what I did was I took this photograph here, I'll just move it to the side, and then I started going through our catalog and we found a match. So you can see that this scar here, for example, is represented here. This big line here, starting out thick and getting thin, is represented here. This little white scar is here. This is from March 10th, 2019, the new photograph. And this is February 20th, 2006. So that represents a 14-year span. And if we continue to go back in the catalog, we can begin to start tracing the full life history of this whale as it's been seen in Hawaii, which is incredible to trace that life history. And it makes you fall in love with these animals. And as a scientist, it makes me want to learn more about them so that I could then teach about them to others so they care about them.
There's our white-pecked animal ahead of us, 12 o'clock, 50 yards.
Unlike other whale species, humpbacks do not stay together in permanent pods, but instead, associate in various temporary social groupings.
They'll be together for anywhere from a few hours to maybe to a couple of days or so at a time.
When you're in the breeding grounds, one of the most common pod types that you'll see are mothers with newborn calves. Often you'll see a pair of whales, and most often that pair is composed of a male and a female. Females without calves are very coveted. They're prized by males.
The competitive pod is where you have a female that has multiple males that are trying to effectively gain exclusive access to her. The whale that at that point has access to her, we call the primary escort. And then you have multiple whales, usually in the periphery, who are the so-called secondary escorts. And some of them will become active challengers to the principal escorts.
He may do all these displays, right, to show his strengths. And so these include things like blocking behavior by the male closest to the female, the head lunge, or blowing a trail of bubbles from the blowhole, to more vigorous contest competition in which the male will go chase a secondary escort, or will go and will strike it hard with its body or its tail flukes, sometimes causing injury, blood.
These are all efforts by the male to effectively kind of discourage other males from coming in and trying to dislodge him from his position with the female. So these displays, whether they be these sort of physical displays that we observe or the song, may be ways that competitors use to sort of gauge each other and to determine whether it's really worth it to go in and try to take that other whale on physically.
Your eyes open now, though.
Okay, I've got starboard beam.
Port beam.
To further study the various pod types and behaviors, the experts also place acoustic suction cup tags on whales.
We have to get quite close to the whale.
This is good speed. Let's see if he takes a couple of breaths.
And then we have to reach out with a long pole to actually physically attach the tag to the whale. The whole tagging process, it is both exhilarating and also fairly stressful.
Whale right here and a whale up ahead. Second whale is closer to the surface, stand by. Wait, he's turning.
So once the tag is successfully on, as you can imagine, the first thing that happens is there's a big cheer.
Yes!
Tag on.
Good job!
The next step is to follow the whale with the tag and keep up with the tag, because it's an expensive tag and we don't want to lose it. We typically only get a glimpse of the whales while they're at the surface, so we can only really see behaviorally what they're doing when they're within our visual view. But the tag has specialized sensors that actually measure the motion of the whale, so we can look at the diving pattern, but also how the whale is moving through the water. It has what are called triaxial accelerometers, which measure the whale's movement in three dimensions.
And then, along with all of that, are the acoustics. What are the sounds that are produced? What's their nature? What's their frequency? How loud are they? And when are they produced? Are they produced as a whale is moving rapidly through the water? Are they produced while the whale is diving? Or are they more frequent when the whale is resting or coming to the surface? It appears that there's a wide variety of social sounds that these animals produce. That's fascinating.
The scientists closely follow a tagged whale using a VHF transmitter that can pick up sound signals from the tag when the whale is at the surface.
Oh, there's our whale.
We pick up some beeps. Once it goes back down, then it goes silent again. And at that point, we effectively kind of lose all control over what happens next. And that's the part that can get a little bit stressful, because the whale can then go wherever he or she decides to go. It can go into rough waters where we can't follow it. If the tag stays on for extended periods, for example, overnight, we can't continue to follow the whale. More often than not, though, the tag will stay on for a few hours.
Tag came off.
So let's stop here. You see it?
Okay, I don't see it.
Find us somebody for that tag. It's right here. It's right here at 5 o'clock.
Okay, right here, right. We went right by it.
Once the tag falls off, it's designed so that it will sort of bob up and down in the water and expose the antenna, and then we get continuous beeps. And that is the cue that tells us, okay, the tag's fallen off the whale, now we have to go into recovery mode.
Then of course, that's the gem right there, right? And we go back to the laboratory and then we download that data.
It's coming right here.
Another one in front of us, 12 o'clock.
Okay, let's try to pace this guy. We may want to go for the second whale right here. Stand by.
We let him commit.
Stand by.
Okay, here we go.
He's committing.
Oh, you got it.
Tag on.
Good job.
More tags will need to be deployed on different animals found in a variety of pod settings to answer some of the deeper questions. But the experts can already glean some information from the whales tagged so far.
One of the sort of data streams that we can look at from the tag is the animal's dive profile. Tag went on here at the beginning of the file, and the whale did some dives down to about 70 or 80 meters or so. At the time, this whale was still affiliated with another whale. And then the two whales separated, and our whale with the tag started to sing. He did that multiple cycles for a few hours at a time. And then later in the afternoon, he stopped singing and he started to affiliate with some other whales. And you can now see that the dive profile becomes much more erratic, and you see evidence of the animal interacting with other whales. And then at some point in the night, he went back to singing again. So this kind of gives us a glimpse of at least a portion of the animal's day and how much time this whale at least spent singing versus interacting with other whales. And it's this kind of information that to us is very interesting and useful, because as we collect more and more of these data, we can start to build kind of a picture of how these animals are spending their time. How much of their time do they have to spend resting versus actively engaged in competition with other whales?
Many mysteries remain. Humpback whales are charismatic animals that have long beguiled humans with their moving song and thrilling displays, including the dedicated scientists striving to unlock the secrets of these giant ancient mariners.
Humpback whales are an integral part of the marine ecosystem. Because they are feeding on schooling fish as well as krill, they're what we call a sentinel species. So they are a reflection of the health of the oceans.
And so it's important that we not only understand their role in the ecosystem, but that we maintain healthy populations.
Malama kohola, please take care of the whale.
Major funding for this program was provided by the Bachelor Foundation, encouraging people to preserve and protect America's underwater resources, and by the William J. and Tina Rosenberg Foundation, the Do Unto Others Trust, and by the following.
Hi everyone, my name is Alexa Elliott. I'm the series producer for Changing Seas at South Florida PBS. And we're super excited to be hosting this event today together with the team at the Hawaiian Islands Humpback Whale National Marine Sanctuary. And joining me today are two of the experts you just saw featured in the film. And they're Dr. Adam A. Pack. He's the professor of psychology and biology at the University of Hawaii at Hilo. And also Dr. Mark Lammers, the research coordinator at the Hawaiian Islands Humpback Whale National Marine Sanctuary. Welcome, guys.
Aloha. Thank you, Alexa.
So nice to see you guys again, and I'm excited we were able to make this work despite the time changes and everything. Just a quick heads up for our audience, just to let you know, feel free to post some questions in the comment section, whether you're on Facebook or watching on YouTube, and then our team will make sure to pass those questions along to us. And I guess maybe the first thing we could start with, guys, is what's happened since we filmed this. So I know for background, we filmed this back in the spring of 2019. So some time has passed. Are there any updates on your research?
Yeah, well, I can start with that. So, as you experienced when you were out, we collected a lot of data during that time frame. And so we've been quite busy analyzing those data, and that's a quite labor-intensive process. But we've managed to get through quite a lot, and we're at a point now where we're kind of in the statistical analysis phase of that process. And once we can get through that, then we hope to have a paper submitted for publication here relatively soon. So that's kind of where we are in the process.
And I will add that on my end, I spent many months measuring the body lengths of those whales that we surveyed with you out in Maui waters. And also our colleagues up in University of Alaska Fairbanks, Shannon Atkinson and her colleagues there measured testosterone levels of those whales for us. And we've gotten back those data. And actually just yesterday, I was looking at the plots, the correlations of testosterone versus body length. And sure enough, there's a whopping positive linear correlation there that's highly significant, even when you partial out the time of the season when the whales were sampled, which is really exciting. So basically, larger whales have higher testosterone levels than their smaller counterparts. And so that's the first piece of the puzzle there. And now we're looking forward to coupling those two streams of data, testosterone and body size, with Mark's laboratory's work looking at various acoustic characteristics.
Oh, wow. That's super exciting to, you know, hear these updates. It's, you know, we're out there filming with you guys and then we put a program together, but obviously your research continues. So that's some really exciting news to see what has come out from the testosterone work. We have a question from Dennis. He's asking what the conditions are that draws the whales close to the islands as opposed to them staying further offshore.
So a primary driver of that is the shallow water that we have here, the shallow warm waters. And so what you see is, and this has been known since the first aerial surveys that my mentor did back in the mid-1970s with his students, are that the majority of the whales are found within what we call the 100 fathom isobath of the island. So basically 183 meter contour around the islands. And they concentrate in areas where you find a large expanses of shallow water, which is our field site off of Maui between the islands of Maui, Molokai, Kahoolawe, and Lanai. There's also a long 25 kilometer spit of shallow water called Penguin Bank, which you also see the whales. And these two areas have both large concentrations of humpback whales, and also it's a coveted area that mothers prefer for calving. So those waters are highly coveted by the animals. And so it is, you can find them on the other sides of the islands, but they prefer these, seem to prefer these shallow water areas a lot of times on the leeward side.
And we kind of have a follow-up question to that from Mari. The question is whether or not they only sing in shallow water or if they also sing in deeper water. And also kind of as a follow-up question, what other sounds do the whales make?
Sure. Well, I can try to address that. So the whales, like Adam said, they do tend to position themselves or, you know, kind of aggregate in these shallow waters. So we do get a lot of singing in those waters. But they don't necessarily only sing in shallow waters. They we know that they sing sometimes while they're migrating. So during their trip down from Alaska, you can pick up in different parts of the ocean humpback whale song. So it's not a it's not unheard of that they would hear whale song in deeper waters. In fact, in hydrophones that are moored, even like as far as 100 kilometers north of the Hawaiian Islands, you can pick up humpback whale song. Now, it's unclear exactly where those whales are, but presumably they're somewhere in deeper waters as well. As far as the other types of sounds that they produce, there is another kind of class of sounds that we call social sounds that that they produce. They don't tend to be as loud as the song, so they're a little bit quieter. In fact, it makes it a little harder for us to study those sounds here in the breeding grounds because there is so much song that's in the background. But those are the types of sounds that are produced, for example, between mothers and calves, but also in some of these competitive pods, where whales are competing with each other. And, they don't sound completely different than the song units, but they don't have the same kind of structure that song does. And so those are more the types of sounds that you'd get in during social interactions between whales.
And I'll just add that, at the end of the feeding season up in Alaska, that is towards the end of that, before the whales are migrating, you begin to start hearing bits and pieces of the song being produced by the males. And coincidentally, what we see is testosterone starts increasing at that time. So that by the time the whales are either most of the way or down in Hawaiian waters, they have these very large testosterone levels. And then subsequently during the height of kind of the competitive portions of the season, that testosterone has resulted in large production of large amounts of sperm, spermatozoa.
And Mariana is actually asking how, if the song changes throughout the season, how do you identify different populations if it has completely changed by the end of the season?
Yes, I can try to answer that. Basically, all the whales that are in a particular breeding ground tend to sing the same song, right? Although that variation between individuals is kind of what we're interested in, sort of the fine scale variation. But over the course of the season, the song does evolve, but it tends to evolve, you know, among all the whales kind of simultaneously. Now, sometimes you do have individuals that come from other parts of the Pacific or some, you know, other breeding populations, and they can introduce sort of new elements into the song, and that's kind of thought, you know, to be one of the mechanisms by which this the song evolves. But you can actually tell that whales are from different breeding populations by looking at the structure of the song, and that's been one of the indications that people have pointed to suggest that whales actually have culture. So this song is an example of culture in a different animal, because it's learned, it changes, it can be transferred between populations, and so on. So it's a fascinating aspect of these animals' lives.
And I would just add that in Australia several years ago, our colleagues who work down there provided a dramatic example of whales from one of the sides of Australia migrating up and kind of visiting the other population. And within a couple of years, that population that was visited adopted the entire song by and large of the visitors. And so that was a dramatic example of cultural transmission characteristics of the song. So the song both has aspects of evolving, and also there are, down there at least, revolutions of the song too, where the song can change over or even collapse at some point and then start up again in terms of the number of themes that you have. It's one of those mysteries that people have been looking at for a long time, trying to elucidate the various functions. We know that it has a function in terms of the mating system, and we're at that point now where we're just getting more and more fine details about those functions.
Which is just such a, you know, an amazing aspect to these whales, and it really kind of goes to show just how intelligent these creatures are and how little we as humans still know about them, I guess, and how their societies function. Adam, kind of a follow-up question to your testosterone work. George is curious how you tell the age of humpback whales and whether or not their testosterone levels are correlated with that.
Right, so aging of humpback whales can be done with whales that have passed away by their earplugs, which put down rings annually, like a tree. And so, of course, one would have to wait for the whales to naturally pass away, or God forbid they got killed by a boat or something. But other than that, what we do is we trace the life histories of these whales through, as I mentioned in the film, the unique markings on their tail flukes, and which at about 1 year of age or 1.5 years of age sets in. That's the black and white patterns on the ventral surface of the whale in combination with the trailing edge. And so we can kind of, by sighting whales over periods of time, we can estimate their minimum age. And we have, in fact, in a paper that I'm happy to share, one of the graduate students from University of Alaska, Fairbanks, Kelly Cates. She did her master's thesis looking at testosterone in general across the whole cycle, the migratory cycle of these whales. And what and we looked at the life histories of the whales. This was in conjunction with co-authors and colleagues, Chris Gabriel and Jan Straley. And combining our archival catalogs, we did find that testosterone seemed to peak at certain ages of the whales, which was kind of like in their midlife, I would say, you know, it was believed years ago that humpbacks maybe lived into their 50s and 60s, but that has largely been revised based on some of these earplug studies that Chris Gabriel has done. And now it looks like they may live into their 90s, many of them, or later.
Wow, kind of to follow up on that too, Cheryl is curious at what age they start singing.
So that's also an interesting question. We did through the videogrammetry work, we looked in a paper at body length correlated with correlated with probability of sexual maturity. And these were all singers. And up until that, it was really just speculated who was singing and whether it was only the mature males or whether younger ones that were immature would sing as well. And so what we discovered that was that about 18% of the 90 or so whales that we, or between 14 and 18, I guess, percent of about 90% of 90 of the whales that we measured the sizes of who were all singing were sexually immature. And sexual maturity can, the onset of it can be between 5 and 7 years, depending upon what ocean you're in, really, what population you're studying. It is, we think that these whales may have been 3 years or older, maybe. We have never experienced a yearling, for example, which is identifiable singing, and we have not experienced a calf singing, although calves, we do have social sounds, as Mark mentioned, from calves, some of which resemble some of the units, you know, the smallest amount, a piece of a song. And so, and also immature whales will produce these social sounds as well. So maybe 3 years and up, but what we found is that singing is, at that three-year-old point, is kind of a lifelong behavior that the whales engage in. We've had whales into their 30s and 40s and beyond singing.
And I'll just add to that that there's a gap period between when the calf, when a young whale is weaned from its mother and when it begins the singing process. And there's some really great research that we're collaborating on with our colleagues at the University of Syracuse or Syracuse University, where we're trying to understand what exactly is the learning process. Because what we don't know is, do whales just all of a sudden one day just begin to sing and they just know it? Or is there sort of a learning process to that? Like you have kind of a babbling phase, for example, in humans where they're just practicing a little bit and just, you know, learning the process of you know, talking in our case and singing in their case. And so that is the focus of some of our ongoing work now is to do some of the, place these tags that you saw in the documentary on some very young whales to try to understand, you know, whether they may go through this sort of a learning phase and babble phase, you know, or their equivalent of it at least. So that is still something that we're trying to understand is that process, that transition process between not singing at all and then becoming a singer. Like, what does that look like, really?
Would be awesome if someone developed a tag that could stay on a whale, like a non-intrusive tag that could stay with a whale for like a couple of years before you have to retrieve it.
Yeah,
that would be really cool. Unfortunately, we're not quite at that point. Getting tags to stay on whales is, as you saw, is tricky business.
Yeah, definitely.
Although I would just say we did have a whale, Mark, tagged a singer once, in which the tag stayed on overnight, which was remarkable and very exciting.
Yeah, that particular tag stayed on about 36 hours. So that's kind of our record so far. You know, if you wanted tags to stay on longer, unfortunately, you wouldn't be able to use these suction cup tags like we're using. You'd have to actually sort of penetrate into the animal. And there are those kinds of tags. They're primarily satellite tags that look at the movement of the animals. But even those, You know, they'll stay on for maybe a couple of months at most at a time. I think this, the longest is maybe about 3 months. So 2 years is definitely well outside of our capabilities right now.
Yeah, and then you're dealing with battery life also, of course. Izzy actually has a question. She says that some current theories describe annual change to song in the context of female mate choice. Can you offer an explanation for annual song change in the context on male competition? Or is there one?
Yeah, that's I think it's, you know, it's a very interesting question. And of course, it kind of gets down to this question of whether the song really is addressed to females or advertising to females, or whether it's advertised to males. And we also have to consider that the evolution and change of a song, it doesn't necessarily have to be related to sort of a, you know, a choice by either males or females. In natural systems, to maintain something, you know, something very stable is, you know, is not always, maybe harder than having it change over time. So because whales kind of move and kind of come from one place to another, a natural process of evolution may be kind of a natural process of gradual change, maybe sort of a more of the you know, easier path, let's say, than through some sort of active selection process. And so I don't want to say that it's sort of a random process of change, but it could be something like that, that is simply an artifact of whales moving around from one location to another and introducing song unit elements. And if we think about these whales as basically all trying to essentially sing the same song, there's going to be a process of copying, right? And so if a new unit gets introduced, then there may be some, you know, some pressure for the whales to say, well, okay, that there's a new unit, I better try to replicate that unit as well if I want to sort of keep up with, you know, the song itself, and allow other whales, other males, let's say, to be able to compare my song to the song that is being sung by them. And so you know, it's of course, you know, not clear exactly what's driving some of these changes, but it could be something like that, that it's simply a process of, you know, random change that gets introduced and then gets picked up by males that are essentially trying to all sing the same song so that they can compare each other relative to one another.
And I would just add that this is an ongoing, not really a debate, but an ongoing investigation in terms of song influences on each other. There's some great work that's been done looking at singers that are positioned near each other and how they're, and both singing, and how that may influence how each other is singing. But also one thing that Mark and I have been trying to look at as well with some of our graduate students is this idea of kind of like the hot shot hypothesis, which is, you know, which you find on a traditional lek where animals are displaying where there are no food resources and males are displaying. And sometimes you have the dominant males in the central area of that lek and then less dominant on the periphery. And the idea is that the less dominant are attracted to the dominant because presumably they have either better opportunities for mating or they're more successful. And so with the singers, they kind of form, you know, it's been described as a lek in the Hawaiian breeding grounds. And what we're interested in is whether they have that same type of characteristic. Do you see some of the larger males or some of the more successful males, maybe in terms of competition in central areas of that lek? Again, because females, at least during the daytime, we have not seen them approach individual singers, although the quantity of song in an area may serve as an attractant for females to come, larger leks attracting more females. Because we haven't seen individual females approaching singing males, it's a little hard to tease that apart. We do see, of course, as Mark mentioned before, males visiting other males. Often that results in songs stopping, maybe the males separating, but sometimes what you see is that the males will join together. And if you follow them long enough, they will enter a competitive group and sometimes are successful working together to displace the principal escort. There's a lot of interesting thought process that go on when you see something like that and how that song then interacts with a decision-making process to join together and work together cooperatively to displace a principal escort is something that we're all still studying.
And you know, for us, I think, that was one of the moments while we're with you guys on the boat is just to be able to witness that, you know, to follow some of these different whales and like hear you guys discussing what kind of behaviors are happening and so forth that we would not normally be able to identify. So that was fascinating. We have a question from Sarah, and she's saying that she's heard that humpback whales display altruistic behavior, and she's wondering whether or not the whale song might have any connection to that type of behavior at all.
Well, I'm not sure about the connection of whale song in, but in 1996, we witnessed something unusual, which was that within a competitive group, this was in Maui again, a humpback whale male died. Very strange. It had never been really witnessed before like this. And it was actually seen by one of the whale watch boats and their crew and passengers, the Linhua II. And the captain of that boat did not know that the whale had died. He actually thought that because it was so unusual to see a whale just lying at the surface for a long period without diving like that, that maybe it was a female and she was about to give birth, which nobody had seen at that time either. And so he put a call out to any research boats in the area with some of those details. And of course, you could imagine that a bunch of us researchers came over. I got in the water as well as some of the others with the video to try and document what was going on. And so we right away identified that from the genital area that this was a male. It appeared to be dead. And then what we noticed as we were documenting it was that there seemed to be something 100 feet or so below, which at first looked like a coral head. But in fact, it was the barnacles of another whale. And that whale was just down there and appeared to be watching what was going on. And then began to surface, started getting larger. And began to surface. And when it surfaced, it literally positioned itself under the dead whale and appeared to be trying to lift it up, and wrapping its pectoral fins around it. Some of the researchers interpreted this as potentially epimeletic or helping behavior. And then when there was no response, of course, from the dead whale, this other male dove. And instead of leaving, just dove back to depth again, positioned itself kind of looking up and did this same behavior over and over again for 4 hours straight. That was very unusual, but one interpretation of that was that it was some type of helping behavior with no benefit, of course, to the live whale. Other examples of what appeared to be altruistic behavior with dolphin species helping each other, those that may be injured, and also certainly mothers and calves. Mothers will protect their young. Occasionally, you might see an escort who traditionally is looking for mating opportunities with a female positioning itself not necessarily for altruistic purposes, but maybe for protective purposes.
Do you guys know of any similar research happening either in the Atlantic or with maybe some of the other humpback whale populations? That was a question from Lynn.
Well, we know that there's a group in Australia that is very active in studying, you know, humpback whale song, and I think they're, you know, pursuing a lot of the same similar, you know, sorts of questions that that we have about, you know, the function of song and, you know, how the song correlates with other aspects of their behavior or physiology and so on. Their work has largely focused on a kind of a migratory route. Because that's where Australia sort of lies, as they kind of, you know, the whales migrate past there. And so they kind of observe a different behavioral context, and we found in some cases they have, you know, somewhat different interpretations in terms of, you know, what they think is actually happening behaviorally and with the song and so on. So so it's interesting because in different places in the world, you know, depending on what the whales are doing, you're going to kind of experience different things, and that might kind of shape how you think of the song and what it might be used for. So you know, here of course in Hawaii we're in the breeding grounds, and so our experience is you know, a little bit different than what a lot of other places have, especially because our whale densities are very, very high. And so we have a lot of whales and a lot of singing going on at the same time, and you know, that of course might, you know, to some degree change a little bit, you know, what we see behaviorally compared to some of the other places in the world. But that's why a lot of this work needs to happen, you know, in different places, just to kind of, you know, try to piece the puzzles, together the pieces of the puzzle. Because I think, you know, from one location you get a certain perspective, from others you get a little bit different perspective.
And I would just add to that one of the interesting comparative aspects of it. But there are several places in the world where we do see some commonalities. For example, in the seasonal and diurnal aspects, or DIEL, it's called, D-I-E-L, aspects of singing behavior. So not just in Hawaii, but in Brazil and some other places, you see that there seems to be more singing that occurs at night than during the day. And that as the season progresses, coincidentally with peak numbers of whales, you see more singing. And in Hawaii, this was a study that Mark was part of way back in 2000 with a single hydrophone, looking at kind of how song fluctuates over time. And that's been replicated by some of our students who have gone for PhDs in other areas of the Hawaiian Islands.
And I guess I should have asked you first, for those of our viewers who may not know, how many different humpback whale populations are there, and what are the main areas where these types of whales can be found?
So in the world, there are, I believe, 14 what are called distinct population segments. And they're found, you know, in various parts of the Pacific Ocean, the Atlantic Ocean, the Indian Ocean. And they tend to be kind of characterized by where they go to breed. And of course the whales that we have in the northern hemisphere are separated from the ones in the southern hemisphere. So those are kind of offset by, you know, by the seasonal cycle. So when it's winter here in the northern hemisphere, of course it's, you know, summer over there. And so those whales are feeding when our whales are breeding. In the North Pacific, we have four of these distinct population segments. We have the one that comes to winter here in Hawaii, but then we also have one distinct population segment that winters in the waters off Mexico. There's another one off of Central America, and then there's one in the Western Pacific that is, you know, can be found around the Philippines, waters, you know, south of Japan, and also in the Commonwealth of Northern Marianas. So these are all different population segments. They're managed differently, so, and they have different status under the U.S. Endangered Species Act and under other international endangered species regulations. So the population that comes to Hawaii was delisted from the U.S. Endangered Species Act in 2016. But the other populations, the one that winters in Central America, the one that is off Mexico, and the Western Pacific ones, those are still considered either threatened or endangered and are still on the U.S. Endangered Species List. So depending on where you are in the world, these populations have different sort of conservation statuses.
And I would just say and add to that, that we do have through tail fluke matching and really a neat program that has been developed by a fellow Ted Cheeseman called Happy Whale, where, you know, back in my early days when we would get all these, you know, hundreds and hundreds of tail fluke photographs, at the end of the season, the students and I would all sit down and we would just go through and match everything by eye. And you can imagine going through hundreds of photographs, sometimes thousands, that can take a long time. You can end up with a large backlog of matching. And so Happy Whale is a program now, a computer program with algorithms that allow automated matching of tail flukes. And what that has enabled now is for us to see in large scale that some of these whales that we see coming down to Hawaii for traditionally for several breeding seasons may occasionally end up going on some years down to the Mexican breeding grounds or maybe seen in Japan. So that's exciting because it's allowing us for the first time to really look in larger scale at the connectivity of these whales across ocean basins.
And you know that you brought actually up a good point with the photo ID studies. We have a question from AJ who says he's a retired photographer, both topside and underwater. And he's really curious how he might be able to get involved or how he could help. Is it helpful if the public takes pictures, like if they get certain tail fluke pictures or something similar and they you know, submit that to you guys or to any of the other databases?
Well, Happy Whale can be found online. You can Google it and it's right there. Yes, the answer is yes. This person can be very helpful and everybody else can. If you happen to be on a whale watch and the whales come over to you close enough that if you took a tail fluke photograph that was clear and labeled it with the date that it was taken, and if you had the location, many cameras have GPS on board and the metadata, all that would be preserved as well as the time the photograph was taken. You can register with Happy Whale and then submit it, and you will get a report back within a very short period of time, sometimes within a day or so, about where the whale that you sent had been previously seen. And I'll tell you, finding out about these life histories and these migration patterns of the whales is very exciting. And those data are contributing definitely to our understanding of whale migration, habitat use, and residency patterns. So yes, very important. And there is definitely ways of becoming part of this citizen science effort to teach us about the whales.
Yeah, and what a fun way for the public to kind of get involved and learn a little bit more. I guess at this point, it's probably also important to mention some of the regulations that are in place. You know, I know we were able to get much closer to the whales because we were under your research permit. I don't know, Mark, if you want to talk a little bit about the fact that, you know, there are rules as to how close you're allowed to get to the whales in the United States. And I don't think it's always possible, or I guess only Tonga is the only place that I know of that you can actually approach these whales underwater. Maybe you can tell us a little bit more about that.
Yeah, sure. So yeah, the regulations around kind of getting close to whales and certainly, you know, getting in the water with whales, you know, vary, you know, quite a bit around the world. You mentioned Tonga, also I think in parts of French Polynesia, you know, there are some places where you're allowed to go and approach closely and even get in the water, but that's not the case in the United States. Here in the U.S., there is a 100-yard sort of standoff distance that applies to everybody that's not, you know, working under a particular research permit or in some cases like a media permit that allows you to film whales, you know, closer than that. But other than that, and that's not just for people, it's basically any kind of, you know, approaching with anything, including things like drones and so on. So there are some, you know, some important regulations there to keep in mind, you know, and they're there for a reason, of course, because we do need to give these animals space, especially, you know, pods like mothers and calves who are you know, nursing and resting and basically trying to give the calf the best chance to survive. And so, you know, these regulations are there for a reason, and it's just important to be mindful of them. And, you know, 100 yards is, you know, in the water is not that far. You can actually, you know, see the whales really well. And you know, certainly with binoculars and telephoto zoom lenses, you can kind of get right up close to them and see them in really good detail. So we just encourage everybody to follow those types of, you know, the regulations that are out there.
And I would just add that in Hawaii, it is not uncommon to, just have the whales approach the boat. So, you know, if you're on a boat and you're watching the whales, the best thing is, from a whale watching perspective, is sometimes to just put the boat in neutral and be present. And invariably, the whales may come over to the boat. And sometimes we call that a mugging, and that occurs where the whales start spy hopping on each side of the boat and may stay with the boat for hours. So there are opportunities there without physically having to approach the whales with your boat.
Yeah, and I would also,
sorry, go ahead.
Sorry, I just also add that in addition to these regulations, that the 100-yard approach distance, there are also, you know, just recommendations and sort of best practices and guidelines in terms of how to maneuver around whales. You know, Adam mentioned that, yeah, if you just put your vessel in neutral, you know, sometimes the whale just come right up to you, and that's perfectly legal. You did not approach them, the whales approached you, and sometimes you can get these very, very close approaches. But even in those cases, it's important to be mindful of, you know, of the whales. And now we do have some research from Australia, again, where that's been shown that vessel engine noise can have a disturbing effect, especially loud vessel engine noise can have a disturbing effect on particularly mothers and calves. And so we're starting to include some recommendations, you know, about how to approach whales and how to leave a pod of whales. So, you know, so if you're interested in those kinds of things, you know, you can visit our website at the Hawaiian Islands Humpback Whale Sanctuary, and there's more information there for some of those recommendations. But yeah, you know, so it's, you know, whale watching is a wonderful experience, and quite often, like Adam said, you know, the whales will approach on their own without you having to actually do that.
Yeah, and one of the really neat things also, when you're on a boat, if there's a singer nearby, you can actually hear it through the hull of the boat, or almost feel it if you're really close to it. And I know when we were filming with you guys in Hawaii, at some point being underwater away from whales, you can still hear during the season, hear the whale song, which is a really, really cool experience, you know, even if you're right at the beach. So, and I wanted to actually say thanks, give a huge shout out to Ed Lyman, who let us use a bunch of the amazing underwater footage that you saw. Our director of photography, Sean Hickey, was able to film the singers. But other than that, a lot of the footage actually came from Ed, who works for the sanctuary. So that was really great that we were able to incorporate that. I also wanted to just real quickly give a shout out to our sponsors. And those are the Bachelor Foundation, the Arthur Vining Davis Foundations, the William J. and Tina Rosenberg Foundation, the Do Unto Others Trust, and Skip and Diane Day. And it's thanks to these donors that our programs are possible, but also events like today's are possible. So thank you so much for supporting public television. And we have another question, and that is, how large was the largest whale you've ever measured?
The largest whale we ever measured, sorry, the largest whale we ever measured through videogrammetry was about I would say it was about 14 or 14 and a half meters. And the smallest, of course, was the calves that we measure, which are, you know, when they're born, they can be, 3.5 meters, 3.7 meters, floppy dorsal fin, kind of mom helping the calf along. But that calf very quickly through drinking that fat-rich milk that mom is producing, not trying to expend a lot of energy, will start putting on weight and size pretty rapidly. In fact, what we found with some of our other work is that mothers in Hawaii will segregate themselves and their calves into shallower waters. I mean, the whales prefer shallow waters in general, but the mothers and calves will go into even shallower waters. And our evidence has shown us that this is to avoid, largely to avoid male harassment, meaning that the males are, even with mothers, some of them may ovulate while having a calf. And so the males are always prospecting for mating opportunities. But when you have one, two, three, more male escorts with a mother, what you see is that they start moving rapidly through the water. Their travel speed increases, meaning that the mom is expending more energy and so is the calf. And so the idea is that the process of segregating into these shallow waters provides kind of a quiet area where the moms can just nurse, rest, and kind of save their energy stores. Because of course the moms aren't feeding here. They have to feed themselves as well as their calves by metabolizing their fat stores.
And we have a follow-up question to that, and that's, what's the male to female ratio when it comes to size?
Females are on average about 5% larger than males. That's what you see humpbacks worldwide. I thought somebody was going to ask about what's the ratio of males to females, and that ratio tends to favor males in the Hawaiian Islands. Even though males and females are born in equitable numbers, and one of the reasons for that disparity is that as soon as females get pregnant, they pretty much don't hang out very much longer in Hawaii. They start migrating back up to the feeding ground so they can feed as much as possible, which kind of makes females a limiting resource for which the males are competing. The only limitation on males in their residency in Hawaii is the amount of fat that they have stored up. And we've found males that through the fluke photography again, have been resighted within the same season for up to 70 days or longer. And mothers, however, with their calves also stay down for long periods of time to kind of beef that calf up so that it can survive the migration back to the feeding ground. So we've had mothers as long as 51 days with their calves seen over and over again here. Calf mortality is about 18%. That was a study that Chris Gabriel led many years ago. So for every 100 calves, 18 of them don't make it.
And we have a question from 9-year-old Yasin from London. She's actually curious to know how hard it is to do the research that you do. Mm-hmm. Maybe a future whale scientist.
Yeah. Well, I would say that it's hard in the sense that it takes a lot of effort and dedication, takes a lot of time and preparation, but it's also very rewarding. And so just like with most things in life, things that are hard or things that are enjoyable are also sometimes the ones that you have to work for the hardest. And so I think this is definitely one of those cases. Both Adam and I spent a lot of time, learning about not only whales, but biology and different technical skills. And so all that, it takes time and effort. But like I said, it's the payoff, of course, is that you get to do some really interesting research. You get to experience these animals, in some cases close up and in an intimate way, in the sense that you get a glimpse into their lives that otherwise would be difficult to obtain. And so, so the answer is, it's challenging and it takes a lot of effort, but it's also very much worth it.
And I would say that I would just agree with everything Mark said, and I would add that it's never too young to start learning about whales and their marine habitat, which is important to protect. You know, I started in marine science kind of doing little expeditions and internships when I was just in high school. I was about 16 years old. And then when my first kind of endeavors into research with dolphins and whales started when I was 20 years old. I was born and raised in New York, and I took a chance, and there was an internship being offered at University of Hawaii by my mentor. And so I was this relatively young person, all of a sudden given the opportunity to learn about whales and dolphins and to kind of follow my passion. And I always encourage my own students and families that I talk to who have elementary and high school students to really find out what you're passionate about and to look for opportunities to explore that early on through applied learning experiences in school or internships. There are lots of them now with whales and dolphins offered throughout the world. And so it's a wonderful time to be studying these fascinating animals, but also to be studying their marine habitat and learning how to protect that so that these whales will be around for many generations to come.
Yeah, and I will just echo that. I'll just echo what Adam just said about, you know, finding your passion, because that's certainly one of the things that links Adam and I in this, in that we both come at it with a lot of passion and have had it from early on from our youth. And that's usually something that you find in common with all of the researchers that are in our field. But I think that's the same with almost any field where people are successful. It's, you know, people are passionate about the work that they do. And that's, you know, whether it's whales or, you know, another aspect of marine biology or, you know, anything else, really, it comes down to finding that passion and hopefully having, a support group, your parents and so on, that can really support you in that passion and help you, you know, follow your dream.
Yeah, and actually, you know, Kimberly is asking, what was the most exciting or interesting experience you've had or finding you've had while doing this work?
Well, I think, you know, we kind of mentioned it a little bit in the film, and I mean, the act of being in the water with the singing whales is, like, I think, like Adam said in the film, very humbling, because you're in the presence of this really large animal that's producing sounds at levels that are, you know, making your whole body vibrate in a way. And that is one of those unique experiences that certainly, you know, I'll have with me, you know, the rest of my life. So it's those kinds of moments. And also when, of course, you know, sometimes these whales, you know, they'll stop singing and they kind of notice you and they'll come by and check you out. And then you have that opportunity to have sort of that, you know, eye-to-eye kind of contact. And those are also those moments that sort of, you know, go deep into you and make you really sort of, you know, kind of put you in awe of these animals and of the lives that they live.
And I would say for myself, it's very difficult to pick out one particular moment because there have been so many over, you know, 20 or 30 years. But in the work, the recent work that Mark and I have done, I can recall being in the water with Mark, and we were got in to do our work with a singer, recording the acoustic characteristics and for me measuring the size. And what we noticed right away was that there was another whale very, very close to the singer. And just hanging there, almost paralleling what we were doing, you know, kind of like listening in, not aggression at all, just being in the moment. And in fact, Mark, at the start of that session, was with the singer and was calling me over saying, no, the singer's over here. And I said, well, I'm with a different whale, like right next to it, listening. And so that was really interesting. And we ended up kind of switching. And so I went over to the singer and Mark came over to the non-singing whale. And we still are trying to figure out whether that was a male or whether that was a female through the genetic work. And that was fascinating because it was, you know, like it's one thing to read about what's called joiners, you know, a whale coming in to join a singer. It's another thing to be in that moment when all of a sudden it's right there in front of you. And you're sitting there and you're gathering your data, but you're also looking at this second whale that is listening and you're just wondering, you know, what that whale is thinking. Why is it there? What's going to happen next? And it's fascinating. And so that to me is one of the kind of electric moments of that I'll always remember. And the second part of that is that when the whale, of course, had to breathe, both whales, and they started moving, Mark and I noticed that there was a school of Apello fish feeding on the singer. I mean, many, many of them, just bits and pieces taking skin off. And it was so close to us that you could see it. And so Mark, you know, said like, wow, it's its own little ecosystem around the whales. And that always stuck with me because I thought that is interesting. And so that's actually an offshoot of this research that we've been talking about looking at, which is the relationship between the fish that we have in Hawaiian waters and how they benefit by having these large whales down here that they can use as a food resource during the breeding season.
Oh man, that sounds like an incredible experience. We actually have a follow-up question, and Adam, you sort of touched on this a little bit already, but one of our viewers is curious how you got into this field, what your field of study was, your first jobs, and then also if there are any programs or universities you recommend people should look into.
Mark, do you want to start?
Sure, yeah. So, I mean, I started out with, I mentioned sort of, having passion for this kind of work from an early age. I think I was, maybe about 7 or 8 years old when I kind of first realized that I wanted to do something working with marine mammals, whether it was initially it was dolphins. And I spent actually quite a lot of time kind of in earlier parts of my career doing work with dolphins. But then I also realized that in order to really, do that kind of work long term, just simply having, an interest in passion in dolphins or whales wasn't, enough. I needed to actually develop some skills that I could then, put to use. And so I studied at the University of Hawaii. I got both my bachelor's and also my PhD there. And I decided to specialize in acoustics. So the lab that I came from was kind of one of the places in the world that was, especially at the time, was one of the leading places to do acoustics, especially with respect to marine mammals. And so that became my specialization. So I guess what I would say is I started fairly broad with a broad interest, and then that kind of got narrowed down. And then from there, once I was starting to do that kind of work, the way that science usually works is that, you start to get into one thing, and then you learn, the more you learn about it, the more it kind of opens up, it generates new questions. And then you start to kind of go, well, okay, so if we see this in dolphins, what do we see in whales, for example? And then that's kind of how, over time my career kind of went from studying the communication sounds of dolphins to the singing of humpback whales. So that's kind of how, you know, how I kind of ended up, you know, being where I am today, and you know, we'll see where I'll be in 5 or 10 years. You know, it's kind of interesting to see how things evolve over time.
And for me, I mentioned that I'm from the East Coast. I was born and raised in New York. And so early on, I also had a passion for the ocean from a very early age. My dad taught me to swim, I think at like 3 years old, in our lake by our home. And I got involved as a youth with a program called Earthwatch, which sponsors research expeditions all over the world. I was a high school student doing Earthwatch expeditions, studying horseshoe crabs in Pleasant Bay, Massachusetts. And I actually came out to Hawaii to study little gastropod mollusks called nudibranchs, diving for them. And then, but all along the way, I was very passionate about dolphins and whales. And so I wrote we didn't have the web, Google, email. We just had, you know, typewriters and pens and pencils and paper. And so I wrote a handwritten letter to this professor that I had read about, Lou Herman, studying, who is studying both dolphins and whales at the University of Hawaii. And so I decided that I would write him, and I heard back inviting me to be one of the first interns at the lab at the age of 20. My parents and my friends were very encouraging of me to take my first half of my junior year in college. I went to Brandeis University to study biology there and biopsychology. And so I flew out, and what started out as an internship became the first half of my career, which was studying dolphin sensory perception, what we call cognitive skills, and artificial language abilities. And Dr. Herman was very generous in providing me with huge opportunities early on to publish with him and to be involved with all sorts of research. And then in 1994, when I was about to graduate with my PhD, which was focused on studying the relationship between dolphin sonar and dolphin vision, showing that dolphins could form images through sonar. He invited me to join the Whale Project, which was actually off of the island that I'm speaking from right now, Hawaii Island, the Big Island, so to speak. And I went out, and I've never gone to camp as a child, but I always wanted to. And so this was a field camp, like a science camp for people from 16 years old up to into their 80s through our volunteer program. And I was out on the water in a Boston whaler with a camera in my hand and getting in the water with the whales to study them very early on in my career with whales. And I came back after 3 weeks, and Dr. Herman said, "How did you like it?" And I said, "I loved it." And he said, "Good, because you're going to run it from now on." And so that's how I ended up kind of in charge of our whale project and leading it every year since. And now I'm a professor at University of Hawaii at Hilo in the psychology department and also the biology department. We have a master's program here, and I have my laboratory where I have undergraduate students and graduate students. And then Mark and I share some graduate students at the University of Hawaii at Manoa in the marine graduate marine science or biology department there. And so between Mark and I, we have graduate students that we are currently working with for their PhDs. I also have students at University of Hawaii at Hilo studying humpback whale vocalizations and some genetics. And one of my students now and I are with Mark as a member of the committee studying Hawaiian spinner dolphins off of the coastline out here in Hilo. These dolphins have never been studied before. And so it is like a new experience to be out there and unexplored territory. And that's what keeps it very much alive for me and passionate all these years, is that there's so many new questions to address, and every answer leads to even more questions. So there are many avenues, not just here in Hawaii, but around the United States, other graduate programs and undergraduate experience as well, and internships. Every 2 years, our society, the Society for Marine Mammalogy, has an annual conference. And if they're in the US, I would encourage people interested to become part of that week-long conference. So many opportunities.
And actually, speaking of internships, we have, if they're in internship, if they're available, interview.
So with the humpback whale sanctuary, we do work with interns. It really depends a little bit on the time of the year. In this past season, we had two interns. They came from universities from the Southern Hemisphere, from Australia and Brazil. And so what that allowed is that they had their winter break, or their summer break, I should say, when during the same time that we had our field season. So they were able to come out and participate with our field work, which usually happens primarily between January and March, when unfortunately a lot of our Northern Hemisphere students are in school. But we do sometimes work with interns during the summertime, but because that's not when the whales are here, that's primarily to help with things like data analyses and kind of processing the data and preparing them for publication. So depending on the interest that the student has, there are opportunities depending on their availability as well. So the sanctuary does work with interns, and I believe Adam does as well.
Yeah, I mean, in my lab, we have an internship program. Usually people just email me, or you can find both my website at the University of Hawaii at Hilo, and you can find Mark, of course, also at the sanctuary, and contact us through those venues. And so we have internship programs as well. Usually, I, like Mark, start somebody off in the laboratory with some data processing so that they can get a feel for what they're doing, and they become a valued member of the laboratory then when we eventually go out into the field. And we have opportunities, like I mentioned earlier, for studying Hawaiian spinner dolphins, as well as helping out with the humpback whale research that we do in many different aspects to it.
And it was great fun meeting students too when we were out filming with you guys. Kind of switching gears a little bit, Carla is curious what predators, if any, the humpbacks have in Hawaii.
You can see humpback whale. Sorry, do you want to go, Mark?
No, go ahead, Adam.
Oh, I was just going to say, I was going to let you catch your breath for a second. But just say that, you know, there is evidence. Sometimes you'll see humpback whales that have, small shark bites in them. Certainly, if an animal is in distress or is sickly, we will see tiger sharks very quickly coming up to kind of test the water, so to speak, and see if that animal is how it's doing, really, or whether there's an opportunity for predation there. In deeper waters along the migratory routes, you may see evidence on the tail flukes of humpback whales that have had encounters with killer whales. Sometimes you see very distinctive teeth marks that look like rake marks on the tail flukes of the humpback whales and their calves. And so we see that sometimes when the whales lift their tail flukes up to dive, evidence of that. Other than that, some of the threats that humpback whales face, honestly, are largely man-made. Entanglement in nets and fishing gear is a large threat to humpback whales. Some of that gear, they drag all the way from Alaskan waters, which they get maybe they get entangled in, and not deliberately from fishers, but sometimes the gear is broken loose and the whales just get entangled in it. The sanctuary has a strong network of responders that help out with everything from sighting those whales and sticking with them until the rescue team can come, to Ed Lyman's team and Mark working together to free the whales. And then years ago, in addition to that, Mark and I did a historical paper on vessel collisions with whales and whether that was a significant factor in injury to whales. And in fact, we showed that not only was it a significant factor, that but that it kind of had increased in importance as time has gone on. There's been more encounters relative to the number of whales in our waters.
And speaking of the number of whales that you have in Hawaii, that was actually a question that Magda had. She was curious how many whales come to Hawaii each season.
So from past research, it was estimated that about in the whole North Pacific, that there are approximately 20,000 humpback whales. Those were the numbers, you know, more than a decade or so ago. And it was estimated that out of that 20,000, about half of them come to the Hawaiian Islands to winter each year. So about half of the North Pacific humpback whale population. Now, since that time, we know that the population kind of continued to sort of increase a little bit. But then just a few years ago, in about 2016 or so, we started to see some fluctuations where the whale numbers in Hawaii started to decrease. And that's something we're able to actually also study acoustically. And so for about a period of about 3 years, the numbers of whales that we were observing here in Hawaii just kind of became lower and lower. Until a couple of years ago, where they started to kind of come back up. So exactly how many whales we have coming to Hawaii each year, varies a little bit. Generally, we kind of provide a little bit of a range, like maybe somewhere between 8,000 on the low end, maybe 12 or 13,000 on the high end. The number is going to be somewhere in there, but each year might be a little bit different.
And that's a great point to bring up some of the other research that you're working on. Actually, Kimberly was also asking what other, you know, projects you might have in the pipeline. Do you maybe want to talk a little bit about some of the work that you're doing looking at the population?
Yeah, sure. So there are a lot of questions that we have about, the population of the humpback whales itself, besides just sort of the behavior and the song and so on. And so, you know, one of the ways that we approach this is through this process of we're using acoustics, again, using acoustic monitoring. And so one of the things that we do is we place acoustic recorders at the bottom of the ocean in various places around the Hawaiian Islands, but also further up the chain in the northwestern Hawaiian Islands to try to understand the distribution of whales across the entire archipelago, as we can learn from the presence of song. We also just did a very, very interesting project where we used a marine drone known as a wave glider that we sent up to the northwestern Hawaiian Islands, and it was equipped with a hydrophone so that it could record humpback whale song at these various different places that it visited, because these are very remote areas that nobody really goes to in the wintertime because the conditions are very difficult to work in. And so we learned a tremendous amount using that technology. And then another big emphasis for us has been the tagging work that you saw in the film, and putting those suction cup tags on whales and trying to understand various aspects of their behavior, not just the singing component of it, but also looking at things like the effects of I mentioned earlier, the effects of vessel noise on whales. So that's another area that we want to kind of explore more. And then we also just do things like surveys, like transects, where we go out with our sanctuary vessel and we have observers, and we use a particular protocol called distance sampling that allows us to calculate the density of whales that we have in a particular area. And so we do those, you know, we try to do about 8 to 10 of those each whale season. And then that allows us to actually count the number of whales that are coming and compare them from 1 year to the next. So that's kind of a, you know, just sort of the suite of different activities that we try to cram into about 3 or 4 months worth of you know, of the year when the whales are here.
And for me, there's like Mark, there's a variety of projects that we are currently doing. I've mentioned some of them already, like studying the Hawaiian spinner dolphins and even other marine mammals off of our coastline here in Hilo, where they really haven't been studied to any degree. Certainly now on our, we have underwater long-term recorders and listening devices called sound traps, 4 of them now along the coastline. These are just sitting on the bottom and they're just recording to hard drives, and they're telling us about the comings and goings of these spinner dolphins, but of course they're recording anything. So we are learning about the influx of humpback whales as well as other dolphin species that are in these waters. And we're coupling this with boat-based surveys where we're taking, in this case, dorsal fin photographs of the spinner dolphins and building the first catalog out here to understand the community and to work together with researchers on the other side of our island to look at emigration and immigration from our little community out here of individuals, and to also get kind of abundance estimates that are for the whole island, not just for one location. That's one of the projects. Another is a large-scale collaborative effort with the Marine Mammal Research Program at the University of Hawaii, Hawaii Institute of Marine Biology. Lars Beider runs that program, and also Pacific Whale Foundation on Maui. We have a nice large-scale collaborative effort with some of the graduate students, where what we are doing is learning about the health of these whales in conjunction with a variety of different measures, both in Hawaii, but also working with our counterparts like Andy Zabo's group, Alaska Whale Foundation up in Southeast Alaska, to look at the entire migratory cycle of the whale, and using drone technology to measure the body sizes, not just length now, but width, and how that condition changes over time as the whales are feeding, and also as the whales are up in Alaska and as the whales are fasting down here. And we're coupling that with the life histories of the whales by taking fluke photographs of them. And I'm taking lots of biopsy samples to look at various steroid hormones. So testosterone, but also progesterone in females, and even cortisol and corticosterone to look at the stress response in these whales as they become thinner and thinner from fasting. Are they physiologically more in a stressed condition? And is that alleviated once the whales are in the feeding grounds and kind of across the feeding season? So those are two large-scale projects that I'm involved with. Mark and I, of course, are continuing with many projects together. And then there are other places in the world where I work, sometimes, as does Mark. And so one of them is studying with Denise Hertzing in Little Bahama Bank, a community of Atlantic spotted dolphins, and which live sympatrically with bottlenose dolphins. And studying various aspects of their behavioral ecology, biology, and also how they are responding to climate change.
You know, and one thing that I know I'm very excited about, I know we were back out last March filming with you guys for a future episode of Changing Seas, having to do with some of the fluctuations in the population that you've seen over recent years. We are planning and hoping to go to Alaska next summer to finish filming. Can you tell us a little bit about the work and all the collaborators you're working with? I know you mentioned some of that already, but kind of what that story is all about.
Yeah, I can sort of take the first stab at that. So as I mentioned, the population, the North Pacific humpback whale population, you know, had been on a sort of increasing trend for a number of times for several decades, until until about 2016, we started noticing these fluctuations in whale presence in Hawaii. And these were not only observed here in the breeding grounds, our colleagues up in Alaska on the feeding grounds noticed these as well. And so it became a big concern because we weren't seeing a lot of whales coming to Hawaii. They weren't seeing a lot of whales coming to the feeding grounds. So it raised some alarms about what might be going on. And so we actually organized a workshop back in 2018 to discuss what was happening and try to come up with some, you know, some working hypotheses. And basically what we sort of concluded to since that time is that it was likely driven by a confluence of factors, oceanographic factors. We had a very strong marine heat wave that took hold of the Northeast Pacific around 2014, 2015, around that time frame. And that was kind of combined with a strong El Nino that was taking place during that time, and also a warming period in what's known as the Pacific Decadal Oscillation Cycle, which is a long-term cycle of heating and cooling in the Pacific Ocean. And so all these factors kind of converged to create unusually warm water temperatures in the Northeast Pacific, which affected the whole ecosystem up there, including the krill, of course, that the whales feed on, but lots of other aspects of the ecosystem up there. And as a result, we think that the whales had to respond one way or another, either by going to different places and feeding somewhere else, or skipping their migration to the breeding grounds. And so that's been the focus of a lot of our study, and not just ours at the sanctuary, but a number of other research groups, both here in Hawaii. Adam mentioned the work with the University of Hawaii, Hawaiian Institute of Marine Biology there, looking at the condition of whales. And then there's also the work that's conducted up in Alaska to try and understand what's happening over there. So it's it's kind of a large collaborative effort among lots of researchers, both here in Hawaii and also up in Alaska, to try to understand what happened to the population and what really drove some of these changes that we saw. So we might try to understand what we might expect in the future, because a lot of this seems to be driven by climatological factors that are likely tied to climate change. And so as the pace of climate change sort of increases, we may end up seeing some of these fluctuations more often. And that's what we're trying to understand, what happens so that we can try to project what the future might look like.
Yeah, and I think that's such an important part of the story to look at, with how our changing planet is really affecting animals such as the whales. So yeah, we're very much looking forward to putting this sort of second part of this story together. Is there anywhere you would like, if viewers want to learn more about your work, anywhere you would like to send them to, whether it's on Facebook or your websites, places they should go and check out?
Well, I mean, anybody interested in our work, both Mark and I have, in addition to our regular jobs, have nonprofit organizations. Mine is called the Dolphin Institute, and you can find that easily on the web, just typing the Dolphin Institute in Hawaii. And also, if you type my name in and University of Hawaii at Hilo, you'll find our laboratory here. Between the two websites, it's a large repository of information about dolphins and whales, and including the ability to contact me if one wanted to get copies of papers. I'm happy to always provide those for free, and help for students, which I often give in terms of directions or for teachers who are interested in classroom visits or resources that they might tap into, or in where they're living, whether there are places to go or things to see that have to do with marine mammals. So it's pretty easy to get a hold of me through those venues.
Yeah, and awesome. I would encourage Sorry, I would encourage folks that are interested in the work that we do at the sanctuary to go to our sanctuary's webpage. If you just Google Hawaiian Islands Humpback Whale National Marine Sanctuary, it'll pop up. And then Adam mentioned the nonprofit. So the nonprofit that I'm associated with is the Oceanwide Science Institute. And so if you Google Oceanwide Science, that one should pop up, and there are a lot of links there to, past projects and publications and so on. So there's between those two websites, you can kind of track what the kind of work that that I've been involved in now and also, in the past.
Well, thank you both so much for joining us and answering all these questions today. It was great seeing you. For all of you watching at home, thanks so much for joining us as well. Just a quick heads up, we have a survey link on our Facebook page where we're collecting some additional information about the types of programs that you enjoy. For those of you entering the survey or answering the questions, we have some swag to give away. So please take a few minutes if you can and fill out the survey. And we also have some future virtual screenings coming up in the new year. To find out more about those, check out our website, changingseas.tv, and click on the events tab. We should have some updated information on what's coming up next year in the next several weeks. I hope everyone has a very happy and healthy holiday season, and we'll see you soon. Thanks so much.